So in this video, I'm going to give you a clear and simple explanation on how DeepSORT works and why it's so amazing compared to other models like Tractor++, TrackRCNN, and JDE. But to understand how DeepSORT works, we first have to go back, way back, to understand the fundamentals of object tracking and the key innovations that had to happen along the way for DeepSORT to emerge. Before we get started, if you are interested in developing object tracking apps, then check out my course in the link down below, where I show you how to fuse the popular YOLOv4 with DeepSORT for robust and real-time applications. Okay, so back to object tracking. Now, let's imagine that you are working for SpaceX, and Mr. Musk has tasked you with ensuring that on launch, the ground camera is always pointing at the Falcon 9 as it thrusts into the atmosphere. As much as you are excited to be personally chosen by Elon to work on this task, you ask yourself, how will I go about this? Well, given that you have a PTZ or pan tilt zoom camera aimed at the rocket, you will need to implement a way to track the rocket and keep the rocket at the center of the image. So far, so good, right? So just note that if you do not track it properly, your PTZ motion will stray off the target and you'll end up with a really disappointed Musk. And you cannot screw this up, because this is your first job and you really want Elon Musk to be impressed. I mean, who wouldn't want to, right? So, question, how will you track the rocket? Well, you might say, well, Fritz, you did a whole tutorial series on object detection. Why don't we just track by detection? You know, using something like YOLOv4 or Detection 2? Okay. Let's see what happens if we use this method. So the Falcon 9 launches on the day with clear blue skies. You are armed with the state-of-the-art detection models for centralizing the camera on the rocket. Everything is going well until all of a sudden, a stray pigeon swoops in front of the camera, occluding the rocket from your camera. And just like that, the rocket is out of sight. The boss is not happy. Deep down inside, you feel your heart sink and your soul crushed by the disappointment. But you light up some greens, he chills out, and after a smoke or two, he decides to give you another chance. Phew. The high is also giving you a chance to reflect on why this did not work. You conclude that while detection works great for single frames, there needs to be a correlation of the tracked features between sequential images of the video. Otherwise, with any sort of occlusion, you will lose detection and your target may slip out of the frame. So you dig a little deeper in attempt to not disappoint Mr. Musk again. You go back to traditional methods such as mean shift and optical flow. Starting with mean shift, you find out that it works by taking our object of interest, which you can visualize as a blob of pixels. So not just the location, but also size. So in this case, the Falcon 9 rocket that we are detecting is our blob. Then you go to the next frame and you search within a larger region of interest known as the neighborhood for the same blob. You'll want to find the best blob of pixels or features in the next frame that best represents our rocket by maximizing the similarity function. This strategy makes a lot of sense. I mean, if your dog goes missing, you won't want to drive to the countryside, but instead start with searching your immediate neighborhood for your best friend. Unless, of course, you have a dog like Lassie. In that case, she will find you. The other tool you look into is optical flow, which looks at the motion of features due to the relative motion across frames between the scene and the camera. So say for example, you have your rocket in your image and it moves up within the image. You'll be able to estimate the motion vectors in frame 2 relative to frame 1. Now if your object is moving at a certain velocity, you will be able to use these motion vectors to track and even predict the trajectory of the object in the next frame. A popular optical flow method that you can use for this is Lucas Ganada. Cool. So now you have another shot at impressing Mr. Musk. He was only a little annoyed. That's right. He was only a little annoyed that you lost his rocket. So to save Elon a buck or two, you decide to model this in simulation and test the viability of optical flow and mean shift. You find out some interesting things from this experiment. After running your simulations, you discover that while traditional methods have good tracking performance, they are however computationally complex and prone to noise in the case of optical flow. As for mean shift, it's unreliable if the object has to go beyond the neighborhood region of interest. So move too fast and lose the track. And that's not even considering any type of significant occlusion. So as much as you want to show off to Mr. Musk, you have a gut feeling telling you that you can do better. Way better. You go to your shrine and meditate for a bit. Spend some time crunching the numbers and reasons why you were better off working somewhere else. But you stumble across an amazing technique used almost everywhere known as the Kalman Filter. Now I have a whole video on what the Kalman Filter is and how you can use it to catch Pokemon. But essentially its premise is, say you are tracking a ball rolling in one dimension. You can easily track it within one frame. That detection is your input signal, which you can rely on as long as there is a clear line of sight of the ball, with very low noise. Now during detection, you decide to simulate cloudy conditions using that fog machine that you used at your last office party. You can still see the ball, but now your vision sensor has noise in it, thus decreasing the confidence of where the ball is. Now let's make it a bit complex and throw in another scenario where the ball travels behind the box which occludes the ball. How do you track something that you can't see? Well, this is where the Kalman filter comes in. Assuming a constant velocity model and Gaussian distribution, you can guesstimate where the ball is based on the model of its motion. When the ball is able to be seen, you can rely more on the sensor data and thus put more weight on it. When it's partially occluded, you can place weight or reliance on both the motion and sensor measurement data. And if it's fully occluded, you'll shift a lot of the weight to the motion data. And the best part of the Kalman filter is that it works recursively, meaning that we can take the current readings to predict the current state, then use the measurements and update our predictions. Now of course, there is a lot more to the Kalman filter to cover in just one video. But by now you're wondering, Ritz, the title of the video is DeepSORT. What are you going on about Kalman filters and traditional tracking algorithms from the good old days? What's going on here, man? Hold up. We're getting there, just bear with me. The Kalman filter is a crucial component in DeepSORT. Let's explore why. The next launch is coming up soon, where multiple projectiles may need to be tracked, so you are required to find a way for your camera to track your designated rocket. The Kalman filter looks promising, but the Kalman filter alone may not be enough. Enter SORT. Simple online real-time tracking. You learn that SORT comprises of four components, which are detection, estimation, association, and track identity creation and destruction. This is where it all starts to come together. You start with detection. So as you've learned earlier, that detection by itself is not enough for tracking. However, the quality of detections has a significant impact on the tracking performance. Bewley et al. Used FRCNN based on VGG16 back in 2016. Now you can even use YOLO V4. In our coding implementation, we use YOLO V4, which you can check out at the link down below. Estimation. So we got detections. Now what the F do we do with them? So now we need to propagate the detections from the current frame to the next using a linear constant velocity model. Remember the homework you did earlier on the Kalman filter? Yes, that time was not wasted. When a detection is associated to a target, the detected bounding box is used to update the target state where the velocity components are optimally solved via the Kalman filter framework. However, if no detection is associated to the target, its state is simply predicted without correction using the linear velocity model. Target association. In assigning detections to existing targets, each target's bounding box geometry is estimated by predicting its new location in its latest frame. The assignment cost matrix is then computed as the intersection over union, or IOU, distance between each detection and all predicted bounding boxes from the existing targets. The assignment is solved optimally using the Hungarian algorithm. This works particularly well when one target occludes another. In your face, swooping pigeon. Track identities lifecycle. When objects enter and leave the image, unique identities need to be created or destroyed accordingly. For creating targets, we consider any detection with an overlap less than IOU min to signify the existence of an untracked object. The tracker is initialized using the geometry of the bounding box with the velocity set to zero. Since the velocity is unobserved at this point, the covariance of the velocity component is initialized with large values, reflecting this uncertainty. Additionally, the new tracker then undergoes a probationary period where the target needs to be associated with the detections to accumulate enough evidence in order to prevent tracking of false positives. Tracks are terminated if they are not detected for T-loss frames. You can specify the amount of frames for T-loss. Should an object reappear, tracking will implicitly resume under a new identity. Wow, you are absolutely on fire, with all the SWAT power consuming you. You power up even more, surging power level over 9000, screaming until you transform from SWAT to your ultimate form, DeepSORT. Super Saiyans be proud. Now you are almost there, and you explore your newfound powers and learn what separates SWAT from the upgraded DeepSORT. So in SWAT, we learned that you can use a CNN for detections, but what makes DeepSORT so different? If we analyze the full title, of which is Simple Online and Real-Time Tracking, or SWAT, with a deep association metric. Ritz, I really hope that you're gonna explain what deep association metric is. Well, we'll discuss this in the next video. Just kidding. I can't leave you hanging like that, I mean, especially when we're so close to completing the project for the Falcon 9 launch. Okay, so where is the deep learning in all of this? Well, we have an object detector that provides us with detections. The almighty Kalman filter tracking it and giving us the missing tracks. The Hungarian algorithm associates detections to the tracked objects. And so you ask, is deep learning really required here? Well, while SWAT achieves an overall good performance in terms of tracking precision and accuracy, and despite the effectiveness of the Kalman filter, it returns a relatively high number of identity switches and a deficiency in tracking through occlusions and different viewpoints. So to improve this, the authors of DeepSORT introduce another distance metric based on the appearance of the object, the appearance feature vector. So a classifier is built based on our dataset, which is trained meticulously until it achieves a reasonably good accuracy. Then we take this network and strip the final classification layer, leaving behind a dense layer that produces a single feature vector waiting to be classified. This feature vector is known as the appearance descriptor. Now, how this works is that after the appearance descriptor is obtained, the authors use the nearest neighbor queries in the visual appearance. And this is to establish the measurement to track association. Measurement to track association, or MTA, is the process of determining the relation between the measurement and an existing track. So now we also use the Mellanobis distance as opposed to Euclidean distance for MTA. So while tensions are mounting on the day of the launch, you quickly run your simulation and you find the deep extension to the SWAT algorithm shows a reduced number of identity switches by 45% achieved and an over-competitive performance at high frame rates. Just like that, you find yourself standing alongside Elon in the bunker moments before the commencement of the launch. You clench your fist. You feel the sweat on your brow, heart beating, saying, "This is it. This is the moment of truth." Elon raises the same question that you have on your mind. So, will it work? You stammer a little, but you answer with a confident, "I'm sure it will." Elon looks forward as the countdown begins. 3, 2, 1. We have liftoff. Your PTZ camera is set on the target as the rocket lifts up from the ground. So far so good. We have track. However, the rocket is passing through some clouds that partially occludes the target. The camera is still targeting. The DeepSORT model is holding up quite well. Actually, very well. As you notice, the swooping pigeon occludes the camera on multiple occasions without hindrance to the tracker. Yes! Mission accomplished. Elon looks at you and extends his hand outwards to shake yours and says, "Well done, that was quite impressive." You can now relax and pop some champagne with the team. Job well done. Whew, that was quite an adventure for which you have learned about object tracking, particularly on the DeepSORT model. Just out of curiosity, you search the net for DeepSORT alternatives and you create a quick comparison. You find three, which are Tractor++, which is pretty accurate. But one big drawback is that it's not viable for real-time tracking. Results show an average execution of 3 FPS. If real-time execution is not a concern, this is a great contender. Track RCNN, which is nice because it provides segmentation as a bonus. But as with Track the Plus+, it is hard to utilize for real-time tracking, having an average execution of 1.6 FPS. JD displays decent performance of 12 frames per second on average. It is important to note that the input size of the model is 1088 by 608. So accordingly, we should expect JD to reach a lower FPS if the model is trained on full HD. Nevertheless, it has great accuracy and should be a good selection. DeepSORT is the fastest of the bunch. Thanks to its simplicity, it produces 16 frames per second on average while maintaining good accuracy and definitely making it a solid choice for multiple object detection and tracking. If you guys enjoyed this video, please like, share, subscribe, and comment on whether you would use DeepSORT for your own tracking applications. And if you want to learn how to implement DeepSORT with the robust YOLO V4 model, then click the link down below and enroll in our YOLO V4 Pro course. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.